Good morning. Today we're going to solve free response question number 2 from the 2012 AP Physics C Mechanics exam. And because it does not have any calculus in it, this question is also helpful if you are studying AP Physics 1. Bobby, please read the problem all the way through part C.
Flippin' physics.
You are to perform an experiment investigating the conservation of mechanical energy involving a transformation from initial gravitational potential energy to translational kinetic energy. Part A. You are given the equipment listed below, all the supports required to hold the equipment, and a lab table. On the list below, indicate each piece of equipment you would use by checking the line next to each item, track, meter stick, set of objects of different masses, cart, electronic balance, lightweight, low friction, pulley, string, and stopwatch. Part B. Outline a procedure for performing the experiment. Include a diagram of your experimental setup. Label the equipment in your diagram. Also include a description of the measurements you would make and a symbol for each measurement. Part C. Give a detailed account of the calculations of gravitational potential energy and translational kinetic energy both before and after the transformation in terms of the quantities measured in Part B. That was a lot. Why did you have me read all the way through Part C, and why not Parts D and E?
Thanks, Bobby. Good question. First off, recognize this is an experimental design question.
Absolutely.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And anytime you are trying to answer an experimental design question on an AP Physics exam, I suggest you read all the way through the design questions before you start designing. Parts A through C are about the design of the experiment, and you need to understand everything they are asking for in the design of the experiment before you start designing it. Parts D and E are about the experimental errors in your experiment, and you do not need to consider those while designing your hypothetical experiment.
Actually, Part C is about the calculations of the mechanical energies in the experiment, not really the design of the experiment.
That is true, Bo. However, when designing our experiment, we should know how to calculate the quantities for which they are asking us to design our experiment, right?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay, before we begin designing our experiment, let's brainstorm some ideas of experiments we could perform. So, what are your ideas?
We could incline the track at an angle, start the cart from rest, and let it slide down the track. It would start with all gravitational potential energy, and that energy would be converted to kinetic energy as the cart's speed increased. We did that lab in class, so I bet I could hypothetically replicate it here. We do not have the photo gates and timers we used in class on the materials list. However, we could use the stopwatch and uniformly accelerated motion equations instead.
Instead of inclining the track, we could keep the track level, put the pulley on the end of the track, attach a string to the cart, hang it over the pulley, and attach objects to the end of the string. When we let go of the cart, string, and object will accelerate. That would also convert gravitational potential energy to kinetic energy, and it's similar to something we did in class.
Actually, we could just drop objects of known masses from known heights. That would also convert gravitational potential energy to kinetic energy. We pretty much did that when we dropped a pumpkin. Although we did use a video camera to time the free fall instead of a stopwatch. That was fun.
It was fun.
Yeah, it was fun, but I thought the pumpkin would explode more.
Yeah.
These are all good ideas, and you are more than welcome to base your experimental design off of labs you did in class. Just be careful to design the experiment they are looking for, and do not just regurgitate one you already did in class. It is not unusual for the question to ask for something a bit different than what you did in class. Also, the materials may be a bit different. For example, the stopwatch instead of the photo gates and timers or the video camera. As I said, I like all of your ideas. However, let's not do all three. Let's do Billy and Bo's ideas.
What's wrong with my idea?
Bobby, there is nothing wrong with your answer. It is just that yours and Billy's are pretty similar, and I think walking our way through two full answers to this question is enough.
Yeah.
Billy, let's start with your idea. Please answer part A through C using your experimental design suggestion.
Okay. Part A. The items on my materials list are the track, the cart, the meter stick, the stopwatch, the set of objects of different masses, and the electronic balance. We need to measure the masses of stuff. For part B, I need to outline the procedure, include a diagram, label the equipment in the diagram, and include a description of the measurements and a symbol for each measurement. Whew, okay. So I've got a rough diagram already. Let's label the cart and the object on the cart. That's enough for the diagram for now. Let's outline the procedure and describe the measurements. So write, use the electronic balance to measure the mass of the cart and the mass of the objects, and then incline the track at an angle, and then place the cart near the top of the track and measure the initial height of the cart above the table. Oh, we should put the initial point in the diagram as well. Then we need to identify a location near the end of the track as the final point for the cart and measure the final height of the cart above the table.
Just a second, Billy. I think we are forgetting to add symbols for each measurement.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
Right. Thanks, Bobby. Please, y'all need to read carefully and pay careful attention to what the questions ask for. They have asked for a symbol for each measurement. Please make sure you have those in your answer.
Got it. Okay. Add M sub C for the mass of the cart, M sub O for the mass of the objects, H sub I for height initial, and H sub F for height final. Oh, and the heights need to be added to the diagram as well. Now I will continue with my procedure and measurements descriptions. Measure the distance the cart will travel on the track, delta D sub parallel. Let go of the cart without giving it an initial velocity. Therefore, the cart has no initial velocity. V sub I equals zero. Measure the time, delta T, it takes the cart to travel the distance, delta D, parallel. Repeat 9 times with different known mass combinations placed in the cart. Oh, and the total mass of the cart and objects in the cart is M sub T.
Great. That completes part B. Billy, please also do part C.
Absolutely. The detailed account of the mechanical energy calculations. Let's start with the gravitational potential energy initial and final. For those, we need to set the horizontal zero line. Let's put it... Well, actually, we already basically implied it's at the top of the table, so gravitational potential energy initial equals the total mass times the acceleration due to gravity times the height initial. Gravitational potential energy final equals the total mass times the acceleration due to gravity times height final.
Mr. P, if we had set the horizontal zero line at the final point, the final gravitational potential energy would be zero, correct?
Yes, Bobby, that is correct. However, the physics works no matter where you choose to place the horizontal zero line, so this is equally valid. Billy, please keep going.
The kinetic energy initial equals 1/2 total mass times velocity initial squared, but there is no initial velocity, so there is no initial kinetic energy. And kinetic energy final equals 1/2 total mass times velocity final squared. And that is all the mechanical energies in the experiment. I'm done with parts A through C.
Bobby, please read part C again.
Part C. Give a detailed account of the calculations of gravitational potential energy and translational kinetic energy both before and after the transformation in terms of the quantities measured in part B.
Kinetic energy final. My equation for kinetic energy final is not in terms of the quantities measured in part B.
Right. Velocity final is not one of the quantities measured in part B.
That is tricky.
Agreed.
I also agree, however, I did say you need to read carefully and pay careful attention to what the question is asking for. Right?
Right.
Billy, one more time, please. Keep going. You're doing a great job.
Okay. We can use one of the uniformly accelerated motion equations to find the final velocity. Let's use the only one not on the AP physics equation sheet. Displacement equals 1/2 times the quantity initial velocity plus final velocity, all times change in time. Initial velocity equals zero, so the final velocity equals 2 times displacement divided by change in time. We can substitute that back into our equation for final kinetic energy, and we get kinetic energy final equals 2 times total mass times displacement squared, all divided by change in time squared. And all of those variables were defined in part B, so that is finally a complete answer for part C.
Very nice, Billy. Bobby, could you please read and answer parts D and E?
Part D. After your first trial, your calculations show that the energy increased during the experiment, assuming you made no mathematical errors, give a reasonable explanation for this result.
Okay, my answer... Well, because it is difficult to let go of anything without accidentally pushing it, my answer is, perhaps you gave it an initial velocity. This would increase the initial kinetic energy above the zero assumed in our calculations.
And part E, on all other trials, your calculations show that the energy decreased during the experiment. Assuming you made no mathematical errors, give a reasonable physical explanation for the fact that the average energy you determined decreased. Include references to conservative and non-conservative forces as appropriate.
Okay, my answer is, non-conservative forces such as friction likely converted some of the mechanical energy to heat and sound, and therefore decreased the kinetic energy measured at the bottom of the track. That's it. I'm done with E and D. D and E. Yeah.
Okay, that is one complete solution to this free response question. However, as I said earlier, we are going to do one more. Bo, now that we have learned from our mistakes, please answer all parts, A through E, using your proposed experiment.
Sure, I can do that. Part A is the materials. My experiment uses the meter stick, electronic balance, stopwatch, and set of objects with different masses. Part B is the procedure outline, diagram, measurements, and symbols. Let's start with a basic diagram with the ground, a vertical meter stick and object, and a height initial labeled H sub I. And write out, use the electronic balance to measure the mass of the object, M sub O. Hold one object at a height above the ground and measure that height, h sub I. Drop the object such that it has zero initial velocity, v sub I equals zero. Measure the time it takes for the object to fall to the ground, delta t. Repeat 9 more times with different objects at different heights. And now part C, the mechanical energies. Write the horizontal zero line is at the ground. Gravitational potential energy initial equals object mass times acceleration due to gravity times height initial. Gravitational potential energy final equals object mass times acceleration due to gravity times height final. However, height final is zero, so the whole thing equals zero. Kinetic energy initial equals 1/2 object mass times initial velocity squared. However, there is no initial velocity, so that energy is also zero. To determine kinetic energy final, we need the final velocity of the object. We know the object is in free fall on planet Earth and therefore has an acceleration in the y direction of negative g. Use the uniformly accelerated motion equation. Final velocity equals initial velocity plus acceleration times change in time. That means velocity final equals negative g times delta t. Therefore, kinetic energy final equals 1/2 object mass times the square of the quantity negative g times delta t, which equals 1/2 object mass times acceleration due to gravity squared times change in time squared. That completes part C. Part D is about giving an explanation for why we could see an increase in energy. Right, it is difficult to drop anything without accidentally giving it an initial velocity. Perhaps you pushed the object down a bit. This would increase the final velocity and therefore the final kinetic energy of our calculations. Part E is about giving an explanation for why we could see a decrease in energy. Right, non-conservative forces such as air friction likely converted some of the mechanical energy to heat and sound, and therefore decreased the kinetic energy measured right before the object hits the ground. And that completes parts A through E as requested.
Very nice, Bo. And I think I gave enough suggestions throughout, so I will say thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.